stairs, right under the stairs down there. In the back, there's a piano in there. Elizabeth was there every day doing guided tours, getting gathering petition signatures, gathering literature, telling people about the history, organizing meetings, you know. She was just marvelous. And, you know, people like him, that's Fred Rossetti and Bob Ashley, yeah. And there were just so many people involved in so many different ways. Yeah, and so, you know, you start naming names and you don't know where to stop. On the Alliance side, Jack Bagdad and Kim Mandry, you know, all worked. Everybody worked almost every day on the initiative. There was a whole group of people that did door belling. It was a big citizens thing, you know.
Yeah, and it really was kind of a lot of people to participate in this process, which they normally might have been excluded from, but as a result of the initiative process and the pre-initiative planning in the campaign planning, kind of one kind of fell into the other, without knowing what the outcome of any of this would be.
Exactly right. Yeah, I mean, there was never this long-term plan. I mean, in those days, with these little, we have champagne once a year, a little fundraising champagne breakfast at Lowe's. That became one of the traditions. Get these two city council people to come down and get a little splash of papers, pay $10 or something, you know, just.
Just to cover the postage.
You know, one thing that I remember when they just did, the university just put out victor's papers for displays. And the Allen Library for the month of August. And I went up and looked around it. And there was one thing that kind of struck me and reminded me how things went. One of the mailers there, just a simple mailer, said, last party before the initiative, last fundraiser party before the initiative, come down to Brasserie, Pittsburgh, with his friends.
Yeah, that's a little place
down there. For supper and soup and supper and bread. And music by Henry Siegel, who was concertmaster of the symphony, the Seattle Symphony at the time, suggested donation $7.50. That's kind of how things went. You know, we didn't dare ask for more.
Sure, because everybody was a majority of the people who were in the early stages.
Yeah,
you know, part of them just were working. Benefit of the big guns.
Victor very much wanted to make the whole process accessible to
a very public one.
And he wanted to be a public process. And it was. Yes. And it was kind of you know, I think if you look back and put it in historic perspective.
Why do you say you volunteered here?
It was kind of important.
Yeah.
It was an important event.
It was
kind of at the time when urban renewal, the old eastern type, the tear down, the demolish, build the high rise, kind of thing, was beginning to fall into disgrace. It was a time when people were just beginning to realize that citizen action could have an impact on the government. So it kind of those two forces sort of combined. And historic preservation was just, as was clean air, clean water. And of course the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement.
Right.
Were all just kind of coming into their own.
Right.
You know, and I think most of us came out of this feeling, gosh, this town could do a lot of good.
Right. Sure.
And you can be saved. You can be these days. You can save the things that are worthwhile.
Sure.
So, and that was a spirit that lasted, I think, maybe for about 10 years, you know, 80s and 90s. It was an exciting time. Very exciting.
Yeah, and then the dynamics of our culture was changing, and people were able to recognize that by their citizenry were being allowed to participate in this process.
Right.
And it was really,
in a constructive way.
Yes.
You know, I mean, it was very rewarding. Everyone who worked on it just felt good. And we did, in fact, you know, save the market building. We did, in fact, get them into public works. We did, in fact, spend about $40 million renovating them.
Because I walked by, and I'm leading my way through.
The market is prospering, maybe too much.
Look at all the
That's a whole other
It's still there. That's a whole other chapter. It's still there.
Yeah.
And I think people don't realize how close it came to not, because, you know, I just don't think that we survived in any recognized the bulldozing and the land clearing and the period of time that things would have been torn up and inaccessible. I just don't see how those businesses would have survived, or how
they couldn't have,
or how the low-income residents would have ever come back. The studies in those days showed that if you took elderly, low-income people, push them out by urban renewal in the interests of preserving their way of life, they usually didn't survive.
Right. They weren't able to return.
I lost all humanity.
I doubted that the market could have survived that kind of just the trauma of rehabilitating is enough. That was done very delicately.
It had to, because of all of the whole infrastructure was again rotting and had to be reassembled very carefully and under the guidance of several architects and engineers.
Yes, particularly George Barclay.
Who has since become a multinational, and I understand is living somewhere in Mexico. So George's expertise in determining the what had to be done was instrumental at the end in estimating what the cost of this might be, and since the funding was already there.
The funding came hard, you know. The funding was drips and drabs, you know. Senator Magnuson was very helpful in diverting. We take a little from this program, a little from that program. Get a loan from UDAG, urban grant from HUD, and get a little here and get a little there.
Yeah. Do you recall any personal meetings with Maggie or any of his representatives?
Maggie was my only personal meeting. It was one time he visited the market, and he and I and just Jerry Johnson and Senator Joy and a couple other people had lunch. Eastern, sorry, or one of them. predecessors.
The old Victrola.
Yeah, it wasn't the Victrola. Senator Magnuson did not go into the Victrola. But I think maybe it was a Bistro. But anyway, but the contracts, I mean, the contracts that I was aware of were mostly indirect to our staff, George Rolfe, and the Renewal folks, Aaron Sherber, and the Banks staff, Jerry Johnson.
Right.
They all worked very hard on doing creative fundraising during the rehab portion.
You mentioned that Allied Arts had really taken a position to support the Friends of the Market, but not at first, just because it was unclear as to what the preservation efforts would, what the end result of that would be.
Well, it was unclear, and then secondly, we had strong and honored members of Allied Arts on both sides.
We have
Jack Morris, that market cannot survive, and we're going to develop a sensitive plan to save it. Victor, of course, moved there for a little bit. Victor was very hard on his
beliefs.
He's hard on people that disagree.
Okay. Yeah, he'd really take them.
Yeah, he was not sentimental about friends. Not in the market, was it? Victor was a very tough, and very strong, and sometimes very hard to get along. But he was exactly what it
was.
Yeah, without Victor, we probably would not be sitting here.
It would not have been saved by compromisers and appeasers.
So on this 25th anniversary, are there any parting notations you care to leave that are under our video archival methods?
No, I think I kind of said that questions have been good. I guess, you know, I guess the lesson from it was how close we came as a community to making a very wrong and irreparable decision. Lesson in my own life is that I think one has to maybe reflect on what the city is doing and what direction it's taking. The city council were convinced that that would have been a very wrong thing. And a lot of good people thought we were doing the right thing.
Right.
And it wasn't the bad people against the good people. It was just. And I think somehow that's
kind of, that's those kind of compliments of the kind of initiative of your group and everybody is kind of captures a little bit of what we call the Seattle spirit, which kind of transcends any kind of specific political agenda and really does listen to the citizenry and what their voice is.
I think that's right. And I think it went on, you know, that was kind of the beginning of a time when the citizens did become involved in very constructive ways in a lot of things like energy policies, city beautification policies, city design issues,
thank you very much for this interview, and let me undo this. Yes, we will want to. I'll ask Kate.
Oh, we're working on this one. Okay.
It was certainly an interesting time.
Yes. It's a, I mean, it sounds, that was just a weird job. Paul?
Okay, we've got the last part of it on two tapes there.
Yeah.
That's what I need.
Early this morning, there was a wonderful pickup really here that either it wasn't turned on or I pulled it.
I hope you didn't lose anything.
We lost a lot of stuff, but the people were still alive and well.
Well, you need to catch up.
And we know where they are. Yeah. So what we're going to do, Julie, is introduce yourself and talk a little about the market as you first saw it. And then your involvement with your friends in the market, how that started and what you've seen it through there and some of the exciting times that happened in that. And conclude, I guess, with some observations on the changes in the market since it was at that time. So tell us who you are and who you were at that time.
I'm Julie Anderson, and at that time I was a housewife with three children. I had come to Seattle from New Orleans, and so the market was very precious to me because Seattle was not a city with a lot of history. Not only did I like to come here for the history, but I like the architecture and randomness of it. It was an interesting time. I was thinking about it before coming down here, of course. When John Kennedy asked us what we could do, I really started thinking seriously about volunteer work at that time, even though my children were young. But I wanted to do something. It was exciting times. So,
when did you come from New Orleans? What year?
I came from New Orleans in 51.
Okay.
So I lived here, graduated from school and got married and started raising a family. But a neighbor of mine told me that the market was looking for volunteers because she knew I was a great fan. Mm-hmm.
And this would be in the late 60s?
Early 60s. I started volunteering in 65 when the book stall, the art stall, was selling books mm-hmm. by Mark Tobey to raise funds for the market. So it was a very early part of it. And Elizabeth Tanner was recruiting volunteers, and she had more need for volunteers than there were volunteers at the time, because they were not only trying to raise funds, they were trying to raise visibility, they were trying to essentially recruit people who cared a lot about the market. It was not at that time given that the market should be saved, and lots of my acquaintance and other people felt it should be torn down. It was not a credible kind of thing for Seattle to have. So I got an education. I always think of it as being an education in architecture and urban activism. I got to meet wonderful, wonderful people. It's just such a wonderful mix of people. And at one point in the market, I mean, I had graduated with a degree in journalism, so lots of what they wanted me to do was to do publicity activities. But because there weren't enough volunteers to go around, we did special events of all kinds, organized and led tours. My youngsters helped carry grocery bags. We tried that one time because we thought that if people...
Like delivery boys.
Yeah, but from the stalls, they take them out to people's cars, and that was a service. I love giving the tours. I love getting to know a lot of the people in the market. That was sort of a special aspect of that, because it's not as if you wouldn't. You might know vendors on an occasional basis, but something about being here early in the morning before the stalls are set up, and coming in the winter, which was pretty cold and unforgiving lots of times, you got a different relationship, and it was a respect that went back and forth. And I had young children, so the children would come with me, which is always, and of course, they make you know everybody. I don't have a good linear memory for all of it, but I think I was there. I mean, I helped promote and organize lots of the fundraising activities, and was very active in the campaign to get enough signatures to, quote, save the market. And shortly after that, that period, then I got a job. And so my volunteer activities tapered off quite a bit. So I don't know what year that was.
Well, it was before the initiative, so it would be before November of 1971.
No, the initiative had passed.
Oh, so it's after?
No, after the initiative had passed. So I think it was in 72. I think I actually was involved from 65 to 72 in a very vigorous way. Certainly a very interested fan.
Were you involved in that first festival that they had to in 1970, I think it was? Sort of a market party.
Was that when they had the races down on the hill?
I was trying to establish when the first one of those was.
I think that might have been after the initiative. We devoted a lot of our energy. I mean, what I was involved with is I helped pull together the Poets Dozen, a book of poetry that was to help raise money, and we launched that with a big party. I helped with the first art show that was down in an empty building here. I helped. And we didn't always have our office behind on the main level. We were down halfway down the stairs between here and Western. And that had to be all cleaned up. It was just, you know, it was an abandoned space, and so we had to clean that up and get that ready for Habitat. We did put out a little newsletter every now and again. I don't know if that surfaced in any of the things, but it was really aimed at volunteers, but to let people know what we're doing as well. I helped with the launch of Victor's book.
Single-handed in here now?
Well, yes, I've got
him.
Over there.
That's all right. So I don't have, we also did a children's art exhibition where we hung the children's art throughout. We worked with the Seattle Public Schools on that, and we had a little award ceremony. We had jurors who selected the best of, and we had an award ceremony which was at a ice cream shop in the market, where the kids came with their parents and had ice cream sundaes. Helped collate the first cookbook. I remember that particularly. It was out of Elizabeth's house. And we were collating cookbooks all off, and they had them all spread out on ping pong tables and hand collating, which shows how insane we were in the whole process. And I remember one book got collated completely upside down and backwards, which I always kind of wanted because it was a good kind of a indicator of the naivete of that. And then I would help go around and sell those, and collect the money. And Elizabeth and I went out to Mark Toby's house one time, his sister's house. Mm-hmm. He was here visiting from Switzerland. And we wanted to ask him to contribute a little Mark Toby watercolor to an auction. Mm-hmm. And so we sat and waited for a long time. And he was a member of the Baha'i faith, but he believed in omens. And so Elizabeth told me that somebody was going to read the tea leaves, and that if the tea leaves were favorable, that then he'd see us. If not, he wouldn't.
Okay. Were they favorable?
Yes.
Oh.
And he was this sort of very formal, quite wonderful man in a three-piece dark suit with a vest all buttoned up to the top button. And spoke very thoughtfully and carefully, but asked what we're doing. We had taken him a shopping bag, and I don't know what all was in that. I can't remember. It seems to me it might have been a poster, but we wanted him to know we were doing good work. Mm-hmm. But he was exceedingly charming and a very formal European.
Some of this writing about the market, emotional writing about the market, was done by Mark Toby.
Well, he was quoted extensively, and a lot of that writing was done by Betty Bowen and others who wrote many of those wonderful eloquent quotes. But he was personally quite charming and eloquent. I'm not inferring he couldn't have done that, and he did write this, but there was a lot of ghostwriting done for a variety of people. As far as eloquence, I remember, I remember Fred Rossetti's writing, which I always thought was just brilliant, because he could turn a phrase that was quotable in a quite wonderful way, and also very true. Victor went to the heart of the matter.
Fred Rossetti's phrase, that the market was a real place in a funny time.
Okay, that was his. And then I remember one time during the plans for the one of the schemes, Scheme 23, which I always thought, you talk about use of language, I thought that they would have done better had they not used words like schemes in their presentations to the public. But I remember I can't quote the metaphor, but he was talking about, it was like trying to get your sister dressed up like a whore.
Yeah, well, it's trading the market, it would be trading grandma in for a chorus group.
Yeah, that was that. But I mean, I think he said some
stronger
stuff. And Ibsen Nilsson also was quite helpful. I mean, so you had architects who really commanded language very beautifully. And a lot of people in the press, including Emmett Watson and other columnists and other writers, who not only loved that and respected it, but they coined a few of those phrases themselves. I think that it was a great place for people who believed in, quote, the common man in a wonderful way. Because I don't think there was a great in-depth research about how much money was being made or not made at those times. And that wasn't really a concern. There was a great deal more idealism. And there were wonderful mixes of, and we used to talk about the old men who would come every day from hotels. And they were, it was a terrific place. It is a terrific place. I don't think it has lost.
Your observations on it now are?
Well, I worried about it getting too spiffed up a lot, but I always thought time would take care of it, and I think it has. The other thing is, it is, it's retailing right on the margin for a lot of people, not the major. So they respond to what society wants. Mm-hmm. And if society wants lattes, society will get lattes. But I think, I really think there's a kind of sense of it still being a real place. This was one of the, I think Victor's quotes, a real place in a foamy time. And, he would have quotes about the era of the 90s, I'm sure. But it was fun. It was fun to learn about language. It was fun to learn about how public decisions get made, public processes, public hearings.
Had you ever been involved in any other political or petitioning of the government?
No, I was interested in politics because I started, as I said, I grew up in New Orleans, and part of politics is theater down there.
Yeah.
And I went to school at LSU in Baton Rouge, and so that was the state capital, and it was full-blown theater in the state capital of those days. But I had never really participated in any political activities.
And the Friends of the Market was not a politically skillful organization.
Well, it had a lot of people who understood that, and its relationship with Allied Arts, I think, was a strong benefit, because I think that Alice Rooney and a lot of other people really did understand political decisions got made. So, while it may not have been overtly a political organization, it certainly interfaced with politics over and over again to the advantage of the market. Quite a great education.
What are you doing now?
I'm the curator of the corporate collection for Safeco Insurance Company, and that's an organization that collects only Northwest artists' work, and so it's quite a wonderful connection to a lot of the artists that I knew in the early days through the market. It's quite cool. There's a thread that runs through that. My youngsters, they participated in that. One is celebrating his 40th birthday coming up, and as I told you, his wedding was here. Mm-hmm. They had quite a wonderful festive setting, and it was not a decision that I participated in, but I was really happy when they chose the market because I knew it was a happy place for them.
Yeah.
So they bring their children, I bring my grandchildren to the market. Yeah. And when I just walked through the day, it was so gorgeous. I loved it. Yeah. I remember why I like to come here all the time. Mm-hmm. I think that I think the market will be safe as long as they're good people. Mm-hmm. All it takes to keep a city vibrant.
Well, we're lucky to have those things.
Yeah. But you need lots of them.
Yeah. Let's thank you for this interview.
Thank you.
These things. Oh, I seem to be a. No. He did have a lot of detractors. His. His dear friend, Pat Belargin, is coming in later this afternoon.
You said she was coming in.
Yeah. Got on file. Does the subject in the red hat have anything useful to say?
But film that or leave it out.
You know, in 1957, I wasn't really a fan of the Pacific Coast. If you don't have any hair, you need a hat.
Now, something just came in the corner. Yeah. You did that. There we go.
That's from the Rainiers.
No.
I'm not a fan of the series.
Are you rolling? Just let it roll.
Okay. It's going. Okay. It says 16.
Paul.
Does it say you record up there?
No, he's still on standby. But all the good stuff I got on this already.
Good.
All right.
Including Mel's snappish answer. You're going now.
Okay, Mel. Mel, you really have a good
perspective. Yeah. I'm sorry to keep pestering. Mm. Are you just getting it adjusted?
Oh, I get
to it. Focus so you can talk if you want.
So this is the 12th of September. We're talking to Nancy Goodyear in regards to her recollections and past involvement in commemorating the 25th anniversary of the Save the Market initiative. So welcome, Nancy.
Thank you.
Can you tell me somewhat about your early participation in the initiative process and what motivated you to get involved?
Well, I have to reverse that, or what motivated me to get involved. Basically, I come down to the market ever since I was a little girl. I love the market. At one time, I worked, what you might say, in the market. My first job ever was at St. Vincent de Paul, at the store on the hill right there, where Sur La Table is. And so, of course, at lunch, it breaks before, after. I mean, I was in the market all the time, and I love the energy. I love the people. It's a wonderful place to people watch, and I like what was going on and all the colors and the excitement, but mostly the energy. It's wonderful.
Because of the multicultural and all different kinds of walks of life, which ultimately find themselves here. Do you recall any of your favorite shopkeepers growing up? For example, like Ruby and the old three girls.
I really don't remember names of people. It's more memories, visual memories, different fruit stands and vegetable stands and the fish market. Throwing fish back and forth and around.
Right, that's a rather new phenomenon. Mm-hmm. No, I don't recall them even.
They may not have done that yet at that time, but it seems like there was at least fish markets, and it was kind of interesting to look at the different kinds of fish and the way they.
So as a result of working here earlier. Being kind of part of the scenery here and working here and shopping here and everything, what sparked your interest as far as the Save the Market initiative?
Well,
is there any specific incident or time?
Mostly, I was raising a family of my own at the time. I had young children, so I didn't have an awful lot of time. But I found out through the media and so forth that the market was going to be changed or torn down or something, and I just really panicked, and I thought, no, that can't happen. I want a place for my children to come and have this energy and this feel and the color and all. And so I called down at the market to find out, where I could go. And then they started having phone numbers of people that I guess Victor Steinberg, his organization, and I thought, wow, maybe I could do something there. And so I called them, and they said, well, you can come down and you can do this, you can do telephone, whatever. And it turned out that leafleting, I lived in the Wallingford district at the time, and leafleting was something that I could do while the kids were in school. And I could just walk down to 45th and University Way. That was my corner. And for several days in a row, I passed out. And that's basically, I was never really in the group per se. I didn't come down and go to meetings and things.
Right.
I just didn't have the time.
But you facilitated the University District chapter.
And I felt like I made a difference.
Absolutely. Had the previous political activity kind of inspired your...
Yes, I was involved in the Democratic Party in the Wallingford District. As a matter of fact, our governor right now was one of the people who was a young something like that, in the neighborhood, and I was involved in his campaign.
I see.
Also, a friend who's now been my attorney for years, Phil Mahoney, was also someone that was running for some office, and it's been so long ago I forgot. That particular thing kind of got me involved.
Right, so being aware of the political process and how these things work, did you ever feel that the initiative to Save the Market would turn out as it did to take the...
I didn't really think about, I knew it's more about, I've got to do something. I mean, I was thrilled and terribly happy.
Fantastic.
But But I just felt like there were so many people involved and so much energy toward doing it, that the city fathers and whoever were in command of this didn't dare do anything with our market.
Yeah, amazing what happened as a result of all the efforts of all the volunteers and everything. And you must be kind of pitching yourself to think that you're here 25 to 26 later, you know, years afterwards, kind of recalling. Exciting time.
Yes, I just happened to see the article in the paper a couple weeks back, and I thought, wow, that's, you know, terrific.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think we're going to do something for children to be able to see this. And
absolutely. So this kind of confirms that citizens, by participating in the political process, actually can find the results. And
here you are. It doesn't happen all the time.
And we find you here 25 years later being Russ Reuter. Well, sprung into, you know, now the tree of life keeps on growing.
It was wonderful watching the days that it was being to drive by and to watch the thing just slowly transform into what it is now.
Would you bring your kids down here then in those early days?
Oh, you bet.
Be running around. And
my son had two studios near the market during his career. was down here quite a lot. He did quite a few of the
Horizon
merchants and people that especially made jewelry and things.
Right, so that made him kind of growing up, you know, under the tutelage of your interest, kind of help around out as a professional artist, and it was a compliment to his ongoing agendas. Interesting. So, when you used to pass out your initial recollection about being up on 45th in the app, were people somewhat confused as to what the initiative was and what it meant?
I think somewhat, and I unfortunately I wasn't knowledgeable enough. Like I say, I didn't attend meetings or any of that. To really give them a good view of what was going on, but the leaflets themselves, you know, were very specific. I don't remember the exact wording, but it was definitely, you know, save our market type thing. So, you know, when I would pass it out, nobody would throw it in the garbage as they left. And sometimes happens when people, you know, be given a leaflet, it'll go down the street or something.
Sure.
They would really look at it, and a lot of people were glad that I was there.
Absolutely.
Very good doing it.
Well, that was at a fairly interesting time where, again, our process became in reach of the average citizen. I think it really fueled the beginning of many changes. So we could kind of look at that time as being one of the early kickoffs to where people really have made a change in the outcome of things.
Yes. I was really kind of unhappy to see the effort that they were just trying to put in go down. Was it for that park that they wanted to put in?
The Commons.
Yes, they pushed the Commons. That was something else that I was for. I thought that would have been a very good thing for the city. In the long run. So I was sorry to see that.
The urban village concept. Well, that is in fact what they had planned for the market before they had saved the market, because they had the urban renewal, in the early days of urban renewal.
Yes.
So we may have had something similar instead of what we've got right now.
That's probably true. However, for that particular area, I think it might have been all right. I've done some work in that area also, and there's some places over there that I feel, for that part of the city, for a city like ours that's metropolitan, growing, getting to be known worldwide, that we shouldn't have those kinds of rundown railroad tracky kind of places along there. Something should be done.
Well, ultimately, we'll see either the, you know, the developers and or slash the city, I think, will ultimately come to a meeting of minds and decide what to do with that area. But in the meantime, it's a stand-up.
Yeah.
Do you have any documents or mementos of that exciting time 25 years ago?
I didn't even save a leaflet. I should have. But no, unfortunately, I really don't. It's all just in my mind and my heart.
And how wonderful. I thought you followed the market, though, over the years.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
And is it a tradition to have a certain family outings here, or when, of course, when people come to town, you take them?
We always would bring them to the market. That was one of the places. And just coming down to shop myself.
Yeah.
All over the years, it's always an exciting place for me, even now.
Without pushing too many buttons, I would want you to recall the shops when you worked at the St. Vincent store that you used to like to go to at your lunch and things, you know, when you weren't working.
Yeah.
You know, I'd be very surprised to see the folks in the tavern next door. So I'm sure that there are other shops nearby that you did like to go to.
Well, actually, the secondhand store that was down underneath, I was interested in that because St. Vinny's, of course, was secondhand.
You mean mugs, you mean? Or?
Yeah. I've forgotten what it was. It wasn't Value Village at the time. I think it was Veterans Shop or something. I'd like to go down there sometime and just look through and see what they had as opposed to what you know, we had at the time. Let's see. Names particularly. I would usually grab a hot dog. I think the hot dog place is still down there somewhere.
Yeah.
Let's see. As you walk in where the flying fish are, it's just to the right. There's a hot dog place. I think it's owned by Vietnamese or someone now, but Asian people. But it's been there for a long time, and I would often get a hot dog or a salad or something there.
Yeah, for years and years. Well, the market here has changed somewhat since then.
Somewhat, but there's still some places that are, you know, similar.
And you recognize a lot of the old-timers? I mean, you can go, there's one, and there's one, and there's one.
A few of them. There's not as many. And then later on, my sister, for Christmas one year, a gift to her, to me, was to have my name in one of the stones. And I know where that is. Our whole family is there, all my sister's children.
Oh,
we get walked on every day.
Well, at least you're admitting it.
Yeah.
A lot of people would be reluctant to share that with me. Thank you for sharing that with
you're
me.
You're welcome.
I'll keep that thought with me for several minutes and reflect upon that later this evening. Can you? You know, when you worked at the old St. Vincent de Paul, do you recollect one of your first moments kind of coming to work, or, you know?
Well, one of the things that I remember particularly was, at that time, I had really long hair. It was very curly, and there was a very strange man that, I don't know if this is what you want, but... that used to come in, and he would just sit and stare at my hair.
Oh,
For hours, yeah, and kind of salivate.
Not in a real unhealthy way, but I wouldn't call it.
But he was just a very strange little man, and he never bothered me or anything. I don't think he would bother anyone. But
right.
But I think the point I'm trying to make is the market was full of all kinds of people, and still is, you know. Normal people, strange people. It was just a wonderful place for people to kind of melt.
I think it gives the lens an atmosphere where melting is okay.
Yes, and if they had changed it to be this high rise, whatever it was going to be, it would have lost all of that, I think.
Sure.
There's no way it could retain.
And that's as a result of the hundreds and hundreds of co-workers that you so diligently, you know, your efforts, you know, really did pay off getting all those signatures.
Right.
Because again, the political process is what saved the market. And that's the citizens, so that is very, very special.
I was very proud to be a part of that, and I still am.
Yeah. Do you recall any of the people that you worked with in regards to the market
concept,
or Save the Market initiative or anything? I mean, did you get the initiative coming off of work one day and then head it up there?
I believe when I made the original call, a couple different calls to the different places, I explained to them that I was a young mother. I didn't have a lot of time to go off and be away from my home. And I believe they sent the leaflets to me in the mail, actually. And so I never really got to meet anyone or see anyone. All I did was just...
So the leaflets with the petition arrived in the mail.
Mm-hmm. And I just passed them out.
Huh. And in the university district in those days, where it was kind of a heyday of...
Yes.
Of a lot of its changes on campus.
That's right. There's a lot going on around that area.
When you said that you were a Democratic, you're involved in Democratic politics, I wasn't sure if that was for students for a Democratic society.
No,
was, this is more traditional.
Right, more traditional.
Two-party activities.
But there was a lot going on in the university at that time. That was right around the time when they also had the big march right down the freeway and
off the freeway and all that
thing. And so people were really into, you know, what was going on around them. And if there was ever a wonderful time to save a market, mm-hmm. I think that was it.
Mm-hmm.
People were really willing to get out and
what was your earliest recollection of the market? As a kid, as a young adult, or
a colorful, exciting, energy-filled place.
Yeah. And did you do that as a, you're from the area, so did you like come with your family to the market like on Saturdays, or would you come with a group of friends after school? Or?
I did all of those things. I was at the market a lot during the years since that all happened, and even before when I was a kid.
Yeah.
It was a place to come where things were always... There's always something going on.
Right, yeah.
You would walk by the vegetable stands and the merchants would holler at you, literally, to come on over, we've got this and that.
Yeah, so there was actually, in the spirit of entrepreneurship, there was a lot of very open and candid salesmanship.
Exactly.
Going on.
I think it's lost a little bit. I don't think there's quite that as much of that as there used to be, which I think is kind of a shame, but
mm-hmm.
things change somewhat.
Mm-hmm. And of course the different, the diversity of ethnic merchants has changed somewhat.
Yes.
I can think about the Verdi family and the Pasquales and different real strong Italian influences here.
Right.
In the market that's made considerable contributions over the years.
Yes, they have. I was glad to see the Dilettantes still flourishing down there.
Yes.
Because I remember when it was just a small store, but it wasn't always on that corner.
Where was it?
I believe it was on the main street, down the ways. I can't remember exactly. Maybe more like where the Seattle plant shop is now, somewhere around in that area.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe the next bunch of buildings down. I don't really remember for sure. 25 years is a long time.
Yeah, and then,
and then they moved over here to this corner where they are now.
I see. So they used to be over kind of where the Seattle plant shop is.
Over in that, maybe not on that same block, but uh-huh. along that uh-huh. run of buildings.
With a store of similar size? Or?
Oh, no, it was much smaller. Uh-huh. It's just gotten, larger over the years.
Yeah.
And it may be that my memory is kind of dim. I'm not exactly sure where they were, but I'm almost positive they were.
Uh-huh. And do you recall some of the, your earliest recollections of like the Manning's Cafe or the Athenian?
The Athenian's always seems like it's always been there. Mm-hmm. And that was always an interesting place to go. Also, just like I said, where they sell the hot dogs, there was a kind of a ramp that went down. I don't think it's there anymore. Where you could go down and kind of sit and look out over the water and, you know, eat your lunch or hot dog or whatever.
Yeah, nice.
That was a kind of a fun place, but they don't have that anymore.
That's good. Our market has changed considerably over the years. Replacement of buildings and the tearing down and the building of new ones.
And some of the musicians are something else that I like to come down and listen to. Jim Page.
Jim Page.
Artist the Spoon Man.
Uh-huh.
There was a team called the Anthem. A man and woman, husband and wife, who are no longer together now, but I was at a contra dance that I went, that I contra dance frequently, not too long ago, and I ran into her, and I met all those people down here at the market.
How wonderful.
And lots more, who I don't know the names of all. That was another thing. I mean, it wasn't just, you know, the tourists and the people. You could come down and listen to wonderful music for free, you know, and real street musicians.
Right.
With a lot of talent.
Absolutely.
It's the only place in the city I know of where you can do that, you know?
Mm-hmm, and be entertained by a cacophony, an assortment of,
exactly.
of musicians.
I hope that never changes. I was really disappointed at the Folk Life when they took out some of the things like the massage people and the tarot card people and the balloon man. And you know, those are the people that make Folk Life and market and things like that what it is.
Mm-hmm. So you, in the early days, did you see much of a, there wasn't hardly any regulation for those kind of activities.
Right.
It wasn't free for all, but everybody could pretty much do their own thing.
Yeah, and I don't know how it is. Maybe they have licenses now or something. I imagine they probably do. But at least they still have it here in the market.
Mm-hmm.
Just lay out the guitar thing for the money and do their thing.
Yeah. So, can you think of a story or an anecdote about the Save the Market initiative that you can recall that has stayed with you, particularly like maybe the night that the initiative passed? Do you remember what you were doing? Or?
I really don't. I probably was home cooking dinner or something for my family.
Yeah, taking care of the kids.
I had four children at the time, and it kept me pretty busy.
Yeah. So you come down to the market. What about parking? Did you just take the bus down, or did you park?
No, I always parked. And there were some places that were easier to park in. Sometimes you had to kind of sit and wait. I don't think they let you do it as much anymore, but, you know, you could kind of sit right along the street and you'd kind of keep your eyes open, and pretty soon, sure enough, someone would come out and you could slip right in, and it was wonderful.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now mostly I park down below.
In the parking lot?
Parking lot down below.
And then do you still have a point? This is several people that work in the market anymore?
I don't, no. It's changed a lot over the years, and my life has changed. And
mm-hmm.
Other than with my children, the memories we all have of the market.
Yeah.
I think they were always proud of me that I did what I did, so
sure.
I could save the market for them.
Absolutely, and for their
and for my
prodigy and your generations.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you, Nancy, for your time and your interview. I think that this will be most helpful in our assembling the archives
for
the 25th anniversary.
I really appreciate being able to
initiative.
Add my memories.
Absolutely. That's
Thank
perfect.
You.
Thank you. Really did good.
You survived?
Yeah.
Just barely.
Oh, we...
I'm afraid I wasn't able to get near as much as...
You did great.
So, I think the preservation of Pike Market was a really celebratory event, not only just for that particular community, but certainly...
Right on time? You're moving on camera one?
The what? Oh, really?
Moving on camera two.
National Guard building.
That was the old robbery?
So we moved back to Seattle in 1950-51. There's a Patterson Road store, and J.C. Penney's Woolworths. Town was different then.
So, your mom used to work at the old Rose department store, so did you used to kind of come up to the market in between the times that...
For me, it would be about 55, 58. I started selling magazines, and the crew was started down here. We went around the state selling magazines, so we always picked up our right here, and we got dropped off. Corn was in the Glenier.
Where was that again? What location?
Well, it'd be down here in Western, a little restaurant, cafe. It's not there anymore. That's just,
next to this old Sailors Union?
Yeah. Back, well, I think the Sailors Union was up the street the other way. It was just half a block from there. The catacombs to the market, check it out.
Sure. So, do you recall some of your favorite shops as a kid in the late 50s?
There was a pet shop right on First Avenue where the Wilsons had a giant pair of pants. Geo got it up the other way, a couple of good jobs. It was a fortune teller for the world.
Really?
So, about where the Campania is now. On the inside there.
Yeah.
It was a liquor store in the bottom. Of course, I wasn't old enough to do that, but that's where the crowds were hanging out before some television. Wine at the liquor store.
And there'd always be an assemblage of characters, so-called market characters, in and around that.
I used to get my hair cut at the Barber College in First Park.
No, I remember that the Folks Barber College was further down at First. Do you recall the name of that Barber College?
No. It's just a... Barbecue.
Oh, that was on the same side of the street, of the, across the street from the New York Deli, or but on the market corner there?
On the market corner, First and Pike. What is the sanitary going? The Pike Place Bar and Grills in there now.
Right, so you used to go in there as a kid and get your hair cut?
50 cents.
Wow.
So they tore my neighborhood down as a kid. I live in Manor Bay. Manor Bay is good.
Remember Manor Bay when it had a creek running through it?
No, I don't. So I grew up with a garbage store, which is golf at his house.
Yeah. Well, that's with Interbay changing, and you moving from that area, when the plans to tear down the market, to do the urban renewal program, was on the board 25 years ago. What was your initial reaction to that?
Well, I had friends at the mayor's office that worked in the Citizen Service Group, Tim Standard, for Les Allman when he got elected.
Also, so Tim...
They really had people that accepted any input from younger type people.
All right.
Back during the war days, so in the early 70s, when it was getting motivated, obviously the ACLU, they stood behind it. We had flags and initiatives to, you know, get out and vote, all kinds of things going. But it's like for me, my grade school was gone. St. Margaret's in Interbay is gone. Catherine White Junior High School is gone. Queen Anne High School, Lincoln High School, I went to both of those, they're gone. So it's nice to see something preserved. There's very little originality left in Seattle.
Right.
The stuff I can remember that's still there.
Yeah.
The space name was going to be there a long time, but it wasn't there to begin with. So I sold fire station there at one time.
Right.
But pretty well. You know, like the Indians did when they lost to us, when we lost again. It's all been taken away.
Yeah.
No voice in local government, and we're fighting disturbing support.
Well, what local government there is, it's not.
I lived in the market with Paul, been to St. Gully for 6 years. I used to come to market meetings, you know, they won't let anybody talk. And the mayor that comes from Colorado, as far as I'm concerned, work, appoints people. But the place is just run like a bad talk stand. Sorry, the camera's catching that.
Hey, what's the, you know, the truth is the truth.
Yeah.
You know?
The truth is set free.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, your recollections of the market is one of the few icons of your childhood and your post-pubescent, you know, experiences. So this really does capture your the essence of the Seattle that you
remember
and have grown to know, and you may not have embraced all the manifestations and changes since then, but the market is it's pretty much within the character of how you know it, or has it changed considerably?
Well, it's changed. It's changed. Do I have a studio across the street? I'm not in the market because it's so political on this side. But I've worked in 10 different businesses here in the market, doing the things that they really need.
Sure. What was the first thing that you did, the first job you had in the market, Larry?
El Bistro downstairs, the banquet tables for a New Year's party, so I made some banquet tables.
Okay, so you worked at the Beast with Frankie.
And Frankie, when he was down the street.
You started out with Frank when he was down the street.
Okay. Well, I didn't work as a full-time employee. I did the same kind of thing at the Pike Place Bar and Grill. Where I've done shows, I had a show out here in the atrium, and one day it disappeared. 14 robots just disappeared in the hangout. Thank you, Margaret. They got no respect for artists down here. Buster Simpson got all the money, put in some water closets for planters. He's Parisian now, I guess. I don't want to sound bitter, but I had trouble getting $50 to repair a deck here on the Triangle that they tore out. So they don't communicate well with people that actually live here.
Uh-huh.
Case of going to hell to get light bulbs put in the alley over there, just because all the crackheads were using the alley. I'd go up on the roof and hose them down.
Yeah.
It was hysterical. Everybody told me I was going to get shot. It was like, this is my neighborhood. I'm going to get shot in the neighborhood.
That's right. Yeah, if you've been kicking around here for as long as, you know.
Well, you know, they're looking for somebody that's hip to what the little gangsters are doing. You go out and find somebody that knows that game. It's the only way to determine. They don't have any of the Western East Market. They have an administration. I mean, that's where they really failed. They brought the buildings back. The storefronts are here. The ethnicity of the whole place, or how you want to put it, is here. It's a melting pot. But it's pretty ragged. It's not my concept of America anymore. It's my neighborhood.
Sure.
Well, just the simple things that they don't do. Those are the best things. The park was a great idea.
Do you remember the armory as a kid?
Didn't they know that, like, people? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I first went in there. My mom was thrown out of point. We moved back up from California.
Uh-huh.
And it was the smelliest room in the world.
I'll be done.
A bunch of old winos in long coats, and I'm about this tall. But it was like the far capital of the planet.
I'll be done.
So I hate going down there, but I got a reward of a chili dog at Cresses. I stayed in the bar, little paper cone. Coca-Cola, so I endured it. Someone had to do it the other day to write the market smell. It's like it's supposed to smell.
Right.
It's wrong to smell of garlic.
Yeah.
Or produce.
Yeah. Do you recall the wild cats that used to live down below and down under, or any of the wildlife, the beavers?
Well, I went to Fremont for my life. Thought I could do better. In the late 60s, I went to Coffee House. And we used to play baseball against the place we got, Victrola and the Hideout. And they had the true derelict teams. We were in the derelict league for slow pitch baseball, but they fielded some pretty early teams. Here, Billy King's. In the old days, the place we got was always a treat. That was a hearty bar out there. So you go out the window and it is four stories up.
Yeah.
It's always been kind of well.
Yeah, the old place to get on. Who were the people who played the accordions in there? Do you remember those?
I don't remember live music about it. Oh, that came a little bit later.
Yeah. How big will not open mouth?
Oh, go ahead, open the mouth. I don't have anything focused here.
So, this was prepared prior to the city council. How about this one? Dear Fred, finally got the plans and Kurt's explanation. It's a big lie. I think that's an original. I don't know.
Okay, is it Julie or Judy Shafer? Molly, or to get this right.
Well?
Tell us the true story now.
I've trained my parents to call me Julie. I think it should be Julie. Exactly. And anybody who knew me then would recognize it, I think. Although.
I was kind of kidding.
This was written from London. This, I think, is a zero.
Is it?
I've seen the letter get big.
You signed one of the original incorporation documents for the Friends of the Market.
That's what you mentioned.
And your office was at one yesterday. Mm-hmm. Who was there? Who was working with you? What were you doing here?
I was filming.
Yes. Nothing in it. They're fine. Aren't they good? It's spinach on the lips. Who were you working with at one yesterday? What was going on in your life at that time that you signed the incorporation papers?
I was with an urban design and architectural firm that had an office in Seattle, in the city of Seattle. And interested in the field of planning and very interested in the college days.
So that was, I think, late mid 67, 64, 65 or so. Can you remember? Incorporated? No, there were 464. I don't think they incorporated.
68 was what I remember.
So that may well be that. Harding Square was in great transition at that time.
We were in one of the first renovated buildings. And it was real fun to be there. It was fun to be a pioneer in Pioneer Square. I know Fred Massetti at the time was trying to convince the federal government that they should, instead of building a big tower, they should have decentralized offices so that Pioneer Square could be saved. Mm-hmm. But the earthquake issues were overwhelming.
Do you recall going to Friends of the Market meetings?
Mm-hmm. Well, there was a small committee of us that sat around and strategized basically what to do to stop this thing, because it looked like it was going to be over and done with before anybody could even get the word out. And Victor was in London, and he was sending letters to people. And, long letters, passionate letters, and sort of a one-man effort to let everybody else know what he could find out was going on, and then and sort of making suggestions about who could follow up with whom, and then basically we talk about his letters and share ideas about how to proceed. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember who were also active at that time?
Well, certainly Fred Bassetti, Rich Hay, Julie Anderson, Joe Scherson. Those are the ones that come immediately.
So did you say that, Emily?
kind of the videotape. Well, do you want to show Kate Kraft or some of your photographs? Were you a very skilled amateur photographer, or did you photograph professionally then?
At the time that I took most of these photographs, I was a journalism student at the University of Washington, and I spent a lot of time on the market. And so I went on to become a serious freelancer. This is,
you must have had a lot of people interviewed who were at that famous
Yeah.
So these, I'm sorry, what are the years most of these are from? From the early 60s?
So a lot of pictures of different vendors, and certainly one of the funnest things about the market in those days was having a personal relationship with the vendors and being recognized in the sort of familial atmosphere that existed, and I think probably still exists.
Yeah. Do you still shop here?
Not as much.
It's still, for those of us who still do.
This batch over here, I think, you know, I was very interested in, for me it was almost part of my education to see a different segment of society than I encountered in my suburban Seattle neighborhood. And certainly the seniors that lived down here were a very important part of it. And also the, you know, the social gathering spots.
Well, that was one of the real issues with the urban renewal plan itself. It wasn't just saving the buildings that were here in the market area, but it was saving the range of businesses and the services for a lot of companies. So, do you recall any of the discussions that went on within the Princeton market about these kinds of issues?
Just that they did, and that, and that you're right, that it was a tremendous issue. Certainly recognizing the vitality of First Avenue, and that it's a whole, and that when you disturb a part of it, you start to affect changes that will alter the hospitability of the area to people who are already, in a sense, using it frequently.
It seems, at least in retrospect, 25 years later, that the kinds of ideas and vision that Lise Victor Steinbrück and the other friend of the market were espousing was really visionary. The urban renewal was intended to change the population and who would use this place, and to make the case that it should continue to serve low-income people. Meeting that challenge, trying to communicate that idea.
Do
you recall it? I mean,
I think
making
I'm
a case for preserving the market,
for
preserving low-income
housing. The main thing I remember, and I'm sure other people remember this, because it was something, was Victor's comment about the market is like your grandmother, and just because she's old, you don't kill her, you know, something to that effect.
So you don't turn your grandmother into a traitor for chorus girl.
So that, yeah.
Which later became trophy wives, I guess, is another
example. But certainly the metaphor of, you know, yeah, there's some warts, there's some aging problems, but, you know, we work with those. And I think there was more a sense that people just hadn't really looked at the market and seen what a tremendous resource it was and what it could be as even as a tourist attraction. Those of us who were involved in that at that point, I think felt that there were so many dimensions to the market that it had value for many, many reasons other than the social.
Yeah, it was beyond the architecture. It was the people and the products and the other relationships. Nobody else around the country was, were you involved with urban planning?
Right, but there was so much federal money for, you know, let's do something big and dramatic. And it was, I think this was one of the first areas that said, you know, let's do something that's more authentic. It was
pretty groundbreaking. Many precedents for making the kind of case that is being made here. I still find it phenomenal that the public understood it. This is the old De Laurentiis. This is wonderful. Does Lou have?
Nobody's seen it. I haven't even seen it.
Isn't that sad? I saw a picture of Saul Amon in there. I said, you got to go show it to Saul. He never looked so good.
There's a beautiful article in the Market News this month about De Laurentiis, and it's 50th anniversary of being kind of reestablished. Anyway, that we were just young to see that.
I'm sure they don't have open buckets anymore.
No, they don't.
A lot of kids hung out with their parents. They weren't old enough to be in school when they came.
There's still quite a few children on the low tables, especially, of course, in the summertime. You'll often find the children. I need Paul to come back and ask me questions because I haven't been interviewing people. I don't know how to ask questions.
Well, we know that they just snip the tape, right? So,
you were very active then from 68 on through the initiative.
Actually, I was transferred with the company, the planning firm that I was with, to San Francisco to work on the project. So after 69, I wasn't here.
So you weren't here during the actual initiative campaign?
No, I wasn't.
But you weren't here then during the era when friends went before city council and the plan was voted on?
That was, yes.
That must have been just humiliating after I read 33 hours of testimony and then council voted 7-0 to adopt the plan. Talk about that a little bit.
You know, I don't remember it.
Really?
Can't. I mean, the only thing that stands out is a sense of doom and being overwhelmed by the machine or the powers that be downtown money or whatever you want to call it, that there's no way you can fight City Hall. But
for some reason, the friends kept fighting.
Yeah. Well, and I think that reason is probably Victor. And certainly the other people who were involved were no slouches at standing up for truth and speaking their mind. So, I mean, it was really fortunate, I think, that so many people did commit to that.
That's my understanding, is by the time the vote was actually was on the ballot, there were really thousands of people involved as delegates. The stripping of the term of being Jordan.
No, is all of that on film somewhere? Is there a documentary about that process? Or that's what this
some
is?
Some of these people were involved through that point. But,
because I would actually like to find out what I missed.
Yeah, well, that's what the end result of it
is. This is going to be
good. Well, I think we'll learn more about that tenacity of Victor.
No, I'm just saying that.
So, you recall the loss at City Council, and I think there was a period then where the Friends regrouped and began to lobby in other directions, lobby federal urban renewal officials. And then for the National Register nomination, was it during that part? Or?
I vaguely remember trying to get it. And I do think that was one of the really significant things that happened.
What actually happened is that the State Advisory Council did accept and approve a 17-acre historic district. But then the powers that be met with the Advisory Council and made some changes in that 1.7. So, I mean, there were several hurdles, and then this, and not getting anywhere. But I think in the end they were getting somewhere because the public during the whole process. A lot of people did learn. I mean, more and more people became aware. Yeah. So when did you first start visiting the market, and what were some of your first experiences?
I think I first visited the market when I was in my early teens with my grandfather, who used to come down on the bus and shop here, and felt very, very at home here.
When would that have been? In the 50s, in the 60s?
In the 50s. And then I really started frequenting the market when I was in college, in the 60s.
Were you at the University of Washington? So did you meet Victor Steinberg during your era as a student?
No.
So you met him when you became